Good evening. Wasn't that enjoyable to hear original music that really brings the scripture up to before you? It's wonderful. Thank you, John. Appreciate it greatly. Good evening. Welcome. Glad that you're here. It's always good to have the end of our time on the first day of the week to be here, spent together, surrounded by and surrounding ourselves with the Word of God and His presence. So welcome in Jesus' name. If you're new to the church, we're delighted that you're here joining with us. We hope you'll make yourself at home. If you'd like to hear more, there's be someone in the back at the booth in the corner narthex. We invite you to stop by and get some more information, or ask someone who's beside you, see how much they know about the church, which should be an awful lot of fun. There's a lot of information in the bulletin. I invite you to use that, be able to read through it, not now, but later. But one thing that is needful is that on this Friday, there's going to be a new schedule for the church office, and that is it's going to be closed on Friday. It's a cost-saving idea, but it will be welcomed by everyone. We'll get our hours in, but at the same time, there won't be anyone here at the office if you try to call in. So try to call earlier in the week. We'd be happy to get together. And again, if there are any prayer requests that you have, please use the note cards that are in the pew rack in front of you. Write them down, put them in the offering or in the oak boxes, and we'll be able to pray for you during the week or any of the concerns that you may have. Again, it's good to have you here for worship.
Worship. The Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silence before him. O Lord, you who never fail to help and to lead and govern those whom you bring to yourself, those whom you sustain in your steadfast fear and love, keep us, we beseech you, under the protection of your good providence, and make us to have a perpetual sense of your love towards us, and to have a perpetual fear of your holy name. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
As we sing about Jesus' reign, we're reminded that confession, our sins being confessed and redemption coming, is central to that reign coming. So now we're going to pray together the prayer of confession found in your bulletin. O gracious Father, you sent your Son to die and rise to new life in order that death might be destroyed and that we might live a new life. Yet we have often chosen our own way rather than your way. We have rebelled against you in thought, word, and deed. In doing so, we have grieved you, hurt others, and damaged ourselves. Forgive our sin for Jesus' sake, and grant that we may walk in the ways of love and holiness to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Now hear the gospel's assurance of pardon. See what kind of love the Father has given to us, that we should be called children of God. And so we are. Seated.
As we come to read scripture, let's first look to our Lord for help. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you again that you have made yourself known, that by mercy we are now included in those who may come before your throne of grace to praise you aright, and that is our desire. So we'd ask that your Spirit may come, help our minds to accept what is being said in your word, and may our hearts be changed because of spending time in your presence. May this prayer that we read now be one that will echo through our own souls, for indeed we find that so often we have failed to seek after you, and we are grateful again for the righteous one who has done all things well. So we pray now that you indeed will lead us into your word, into truth, into worship. For it's in the precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ that we pray. Amen. We are in Daniel chapter 9. If you're using the church Bible, that can be found on page 746. And we're going to be reading the majority of the passage from verses 1 through 19, which is a prayer that Daniel gives before the Lord. In the first year of Darius, the son of Ahasuerus, by descent a Mede, who was made king over the realm of the Chaldeans, in the first year of his reign, I, Daniel, perceived in the books the number of years that, according to the word of the Lord to Jeremiah the prophet, must pass before the end of the desolations of Jerusalem, namely 70 years. Then I turned my face to the Lord God, seeking him by prayer and pleas for mercy with fasting and sackcloth and ashes. I prayed to the Lord my God and made confession, saying, O Lord, the great and awesome God who keeps covenant and steadfast love with those who love him and keep his commandments, we have sinned and done wrong and acted wickedly and rebelled, turning aside from your commandments and rules. We have not listened to your servants, the prophets, who spoke in your name to our kings, our princes, and our fathers, and to all the people of the land. To you, O Lord, belongs righteousness, but to us, open shame, as at this day, to the men of Judah, to the inhabitants of Jerusalem, and to all Israel, those who are near and those who are far away, in all the lands to which you have driven them, because of the treachery that they have committed against you. To us, O Lord, belongs open shame, to our kings, to our princes, and to our fathers, because we have sinned against you. To the Lord, our God, belong mercy and forgiveness, for we have rebelled against him and have not obeyed the voice of the Lord our God by walking in his laws, which he set before us by his servant, their servants, the prophets. All Israel has transgressed your law and turned aside, refusing to obey your voice. And the curse and the oath that are written in the law of Moses, the servant of God, has been poured out upon us because we have sinned against him. He has confirmed his words, which he spoke against us and against our rulers who ruled us, by bringing upon us a great calamity. For under the whole heaven, there has not been done anything like what has been done against Jerusalem. As it is written in the law of Moses, all this calamity has come upon us, yet we have not entreated the favor of the Lord our God, turning from our iniquities and gaining insight by your truth. Therefore, the Lord has kept ready the calamity and has brought it upon us. For the Lord our God is righteous in all the works that he has done, and we have not obeyed his voice. And now, O Lord our God, who brought your people out of Egypt with a mighty hand and have made a name for yourself, as at this day we have sinned, we have done wickedly. O Lord, according to all your righteous acts, let your anger and your wrath turn away from your city, Jerusalem, your holy hill, because of our sins and for the iniquities of our fathers. Jerusalem and your people have become a byword among all who are around us. Now, therefore, O our God, listen to the prayer of your servant and to his pleas for mercy, and for your own sake, O Lord, make your face to shine upon your sanctuary, which is desolate. O my God, incline your ear and hear. Open your eyes and see our desolations and the city that is called by your name. For we do not present our pleas before you because of our righteousness, but because of your great mercy. O Lord, hear. O Lord, forgive. O Lord, pay attention and act. Delay not for your own sake, O my God, because your city and your people are called by your name.
Let's pray. O God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you are a true fountain, overflowing and creating this creation out of love, creating us and giving perfect gifts. And we thank you for these gifts and blessings that you pour out upon us, and most of all, for the redemption that you accomplished for us in Christ. And we pray that you would use now these gifts and offerings so that that redemption might overflow to the rest of Philadelphia and throughout this world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Amen. Let's turn in our Bibles then to Daniel chapter 9. Some of the more popular tabloid press and the evening chat shows have an obsession, it appears, with the private lives of public people. And all of us are interested, I suppose, when we read the biography of some great personality, to try and discover what it is that made them tick. What were they like behind closed doors? In the book of Daniel, we've been introduced to this person who begins probably in chapter 1 with his teenage years. He's taken as a captive, really, from Jerusalem to Babylon. He's put into the University of Babylon. There he studies the language, the law, the culture of Babylon, and he very quickly with his friends finds a place in the Babylonian civil service. And in that civil service, all of them seem to race to the top of the tree, and Daniel particularly, we find operating at the very highest levels of Babylonian society for many, many years. We see him standing out against the anti-God trends that were operating in the society around him. In the first six chapters of the book, we're given hints of his place in the larger scene of world history. In the final six chapters, we're seeing something of the spiritual insights that God gave him about not only his own time, but of our time and time beyond our time. But there is an evangelical dictum, a principle. It goes back as far as John Owen, the great 17th century Puritan leader. And it goes like this. What a person is, in secret, on their knees, before God, that they are, and no more. And since this is true then, it is in this chapter that we learn who Daniel really was. We discover the secret of his usefulness in the secular world in which he operated. His daily life, his daily occupation was not the occupation of a priest or a prophet. He was not a minister or a missionary. He had a very secular job in a very pagan context. That was his day job, and was for perhaps as many as 80 years. But he had a secret. We've seen that secret hinted at. There was a point when his life was on the line, and one of the ways in which they tried to get him was it became known that here he was, he prayed daily, at least three times a day, facing Jerusalem. That was not because there was magic in facing Jerusalem, but it was making a point that he's praying that God would achieve his purposes and that the God of Israel, who is the only God there is, would accomplish his purposes in the world. There have been hints. But now we discover what it is that wired this man. And the secret of this man's life is that he was a man of the word and prayer. We're told in verse 1 that it was the first year of the rule of Darius the Mede. Nebuchadnezzar is long gone. Belshazzar, one of his successors, he is now gone. The Babylonian Empire that brought him, Daniel, and his friends into slavery in Babylon has now gone. It's disappeared. It's been taken over by the Medo-Persian Empire. This is a time of transition. And what do we find Daniel doing? On his own, after he's finished his daily work, in his own flat there in the royal palace, we find Daniel engaged in Bible study. He's reading the prophet Jeremiah. And there are some things that kind of strike you about that before we dive into the text. You notice how quickly the writings of Jeremiah have become accepted as scripture. You'll notice that if you notice that at the beginning of this section, we're told that he's reading Jeremiah the prophet, and then at the end of the section, he tells us that he's been reading Scripture. Already within 70 years, Jeremiah's writings are accepted by the Jews as Holy Scripture. That means they accepted the writings of Jeremiah as being without error, as being the very outbreathed word of God. Daniel believes, as we believe, and as Peter put it, that holy men of God wrote as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. What strikes us secondly is how book-orientated Daniel is in his own personal life. We might have expected it to be otherwise, knowing as we do that Daniel is the one who has visions himself and who interprets the visions of others, we might be surprised to discover that in his own Christian life, you know, his own believing life, his own spiritual experience, his own personal understanding of the will of God was dominated by the Scriptures. In fact, we learn that the whole community in Babylon, separated from Jerusalem and the temple, found their faith sustained by the books they brought with them. These books, these sacred writings, these Scriptures were what kept their faith and their theology and their worship complete, united, alive, and faithful. We might be tempted to think that Daniel would have gotten along with the visions that he had. Some of us are tempted perhaps to think that God has a better way of communicating with us his will, perhaps through visions or through voices. Visions and voices seem to be more immediate, more satisfactory. But you think about it for a moment. A vision never stays. It goes away. It evaporates. You're left wondering somewhere down the road, did I really see that or did I imagine that? Did that really happen to me? Or was it an illusion? And it's the same with voices. Someone says something to you. You hear a voice saying something. After a little while, did I really hear that? Is that exactly what was said? But written words never go away. Their meanings don't change. Christianity, like Judaism, is a revealed religion. God has revealed himself in space and time and history, and what has been revealed has been written. Daniel's mind is gripped by the written word of God. Like a greater than Daniel, the Lord Jesus Christ, who tied his conscience to what is written. J.I. Packer says that Scripture is Christ's textbook and goes on to say this, loyalty to Christ, our risen Savior and enthroned Lord, calls for total submission to Scripture, and anyone or any church declining to believe and to do what is written there or failing in practice to be faithful to it is to that extent a rebel against Christ. Like Daniel, we are given the written word and the illuminating spirit. And what I want to look at this evening is the effect of the word of God on Daniel, and I want to pray that it might have the same effect on earth, on us. I want you to notice three effects of God's word on Daniel. First of all, God's word got him wondering. God's word got him wondering. If Daniel hadn't taken the Scripture so seriously, or if he hadn't been so concerned for the needs of his own people, there would not have been a problem. But as it was, reading the text of Scripture created a tension. A tension between what was written and what was happening around him. And the specific problem was this. Daniel had been reading the words of Jeremiah the prophet. It may very well be that as a little boy, he was taken along to hear Jeremiah preaching in Jerusalem before he was taken into captivity in Babylon. I remember as a little boy being taken by my parents to the Kelvin Hall. I was perhaps 4 years of age, to the Kelvin Hall in Glasgow to hear Billy Graham preach in a great All-Scotland crusade. I don't remember Billy Graham preaching, but I remember the crowds, and I remember the people lined up on the streets singing "To God Be the Glory." And as we went home in the subway and on the bus, people on the bus were still singing the hymns. So great was the impression. I remember that. Perhaps Daniel remembered hearing Jeremiah preach. But as he's reading the prophet Jeremiah, he starts to read these words. We know these are the words he's reading because of the reference that he makes to them in verse 2 of our chapter. He had been reading that according to the word of the Lord through Jeremiah the prophet, that a period of time, 70 years, were to pass before the destruction and desolations of Jerusalem would be over. Here's what he was reading. "Thus says the Lord of hosts, because you have not obeyed my words, behold, I will send for all the tribes of the north, declares the Lord, for Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, my servant, and I will bring them against this land. I will devote this land to destruction and make it a horror, a hissing, an everlasting desolation." That's exactly what happened. Nebuchadnezzar came and he took the people away. He demolished the city. He destroyed the temple. Jeremiah goes on, "Moreover, I will banish from the city the voice of mirth and the voice of gladness and the voice of the bridegroom and the voice of the bride and the grinding of millstones and light of the lamp. The whole land shall become a ruin and a waste. And these nations shall serve the king of Babylon for 70 years. Many young people, himself included, had been taken in their teenage years, taken away into captivity, and the land had been filled with depression and tears. And now Babylon is gone. Persia is in control, but they're still there in Babylon. And so he continues reading in Jeremiah the prophet. He comes to chapter 29, as we know it. And he reads this, "Thus says the Lord, when 70 years are completed for Babylon, I will visit you. And I will fulfill my promise and bring you back to this place. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans for wholeness and not evil, to give you a future and a hope. Then you will call on me and come and pray to me, and I will hear you." You see, there's this promise. The promise was that there would be restoration of the people to the Lord. But as he looked from his room in the palace of the king of Babylon, and as he's finished his day's work in the Babylonian civil service, there is no change. No change in his circumstances, no change in his people's circumstances. They're still in captivity in Babylon. Nor does he see any change of heart among his own people. He sees no prayer meetings. He sees no mass movement of calling on the name of the Lord. He does not see any kind of spiritual revival. And God's word got him wondering. That's what he tells us. "I perceived in the books the numbers of years." And he's wondering, how come God says this and circumstances are like this? And you know, there are times when we read the Bible, that's exactly the effect it has on us. We read the words, "In all things God works for the good of those who love him," and we look around and we wonder, when bad things happen to good people. Or we learn from the Bible that we are to forgive Mary Jane, and we say, and we feel in our hearts, "But I can't forgive her. My feelings of resentment don't go away." And God's word gets us wondering when we read, "Forgiving each other as the Lord has forgiven you." What do I do when Scripture and my experience clash? The lesson of Daniel in this book is you don't run away from the tension. God wants that tension to be a creative thing, not a destructive thing. Some of us need more of this kind of tension in our lives if we're going to learn to do his will. What we mustn't do is panic and run away when the word of God gets us wondering. The second effect of Scripture on Daniel is this. God's word gets him working. God's word gets him working. I want to read again those words from Jeremiah 29. Then you will call upon me and come and pray to me, and I will hear you. You will seek me and find me. When you seek for me with all your heart, I will be found by you, declares the Lord. What is Daniel's reaction? Well, he doesn't panic. He doesn't despair. He isn't fatalistic. He doesn't pass the buck. He doesn't say, will someone do something about this? Like we sometimes do. No, he gets down to business. Look what he says in verse 3. Then I turned my face to the Lord God, seeking him by prayer and pleas for mercy with fasting and sackcloth and ashes. I prayed to the Lord my God. So here's the lesson about the relationship between God's sovereignty on the one hand and human responsibility on the other. God had made a statement of intent. I will restore my people. But instead of Daniel thinking to himself, well, what will be, que sera, sera, he gets down to the business of prayer. Why? Because he's read the word of God. I will deliver you, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Then you will call upon me and come and pray to me, and I will hear you. He gets down to the work of prayer. And as you listen to his prayer, you see how much of his prayer life is framed in the language of the Scripture. Because Daniel has learned where prayer fits in this relationship that we have with God. The kind of relationship we have with God is the kind of relationship in which God initiates the conversation. You know, when you meet a member of the royal family, you're not supposed to make the first move in conversation. You're meant to wait till they initiate the conversation. I've tried, by the way, to put this into place in churches with me taking the place of the royal family just for fun. And it's not worked. So there you go. But that's the way it works. And in the relationship with God, God gets to talk first, then we respond. And why we read the Bible before we pray is for this reason. We need to let God dictate the agenda of the conversation. We need God to raise the subjects about which he wants us to pray. And that's what was happening here in Jeremiah 29. As Daniel read it, as God makes his promise, what does God then go on to say? He says, then call upon me, come and pray to me, and I will hear. When you seek me with all your heart, I will be found by you, declares the Lord. And so he begins to pray. It's not normal, not just ordinary prayer. Petitions, that word is used, accompanied by the rigorous discipline of fasting and sackcloth and ashes. Those are just to emphasize he was serious. He uses one of the most beautiful descriptions of prayer to be found anywhere in the Bible. So I turned my face to the Lord, seeking him by prayers and pleas. You see, God's purposes are never revealed in the Bible as excuses for inaction, but as incentives for action. And he comes and he offers these prayers because God intends that he will act through the prayers of his people. It's one of the most beautiful pictures in the book of Revelation in chapter 8. I'm really looking forward to doing Revelation one day. So if you stay on long enough, you will get there. But in Revelation chapter 8, there's this remarkable description of the prayers of the saints mixed with the incense from the altar. And they're kind of ascending to God in heaven. And God in heaven and the saints in heaven and the angels in heaven see this incense gathering up, as it were, from the martyrs and the believers down on earth, gathering up, ascending into heaven, and they're hearing the prayers of the people of God. And one of the angels is commanded to take this great censer and to gather the prayers of the saints and then to take fire from the altar of God and to mix the fire with the incense, the prayers of the saints, and then to throw it out down onto the world with thunder and rumblings and flashes of lightning and earthquakes. And the picture is this: the prayers of the saints mixed with the fire of God achieve God's purposes on the earth. Someone has put it like this: first, God decides what he's going to do. Second, he stirs up his people to pray about it. And third, he does what he's going to do in answer to the prayers of his people. Isn't that amazing? How many of us turn the problems, the questions, the apparent contradictions of life into matters of aggressive, ongoing prayer? Somebody has said, it's not so much that we pray for the work. Prayer is the work. That's why you always feel sleepy when you pray. You do, don't you, you see? You smile spontaneously because that's it. You can do anything until you start to pray. You're really serious about getting some sleep tonight, you try praying. That'll solve your insomnia. Always does. That's because it's work. It's work. Professor Richard Lovelace, who was a professor in Boston at one point, puts it like this: there is an inherent gravity in human sin, a kind of atrophy of human nature that guarantees that the spiritual life will run down unless it is renewed by the channel of dependent prayer. And in response to prayer, God pours out his spirit and revives the declining life of his people. God's work got him wondering. God's work got him working as he gets into this business of believing prayer. And thirdly, God's word got him worshiping. Daniel's prayer is an act of worship. We saw that as we were hearing it read to us earlier. He worships a God who has spoken. He talks. Let me run down some of the phrases that are used. You can pick them out for yourself later. The word of the Lord's given to Jeremiah the prophet. He believed that. He believed that God had spoken and was not silent. That in the past, God spoke to our forefathers through the prophets many times and in various ways. And he refers to this word over and over. He expresses God's command and laws, verse 5. He talks about God giving the word through your servant, the prophets, in verse 6. He says that word contains the curses and the sworn judgments written in the law of Moses. He says in verse 12 that these are God's own spoken words. The basis of all prayer is what God has promised to do in his word. That's why the prayer of faith in James 5 is prayer that rests on what God has promised to do. We are, when we pray, like children who come to their dad and they say, "But dad, you said." That was always the golden key that opened the door, certainly with my children. If they came to me and they said, "But dad, you said." And so Daniel comes to the Lord and he says, "But Lord, you promised." C.H. Spurgeon, when he's describing the prayer gatherings that they had there in the Metropolitan Tabernacle in that very fruitful period of his ministry, said, you come in there and you see these people and they are plying heaven with the promises of God. They are throwing God's promises back into his face. You said. And believing prayer does that. It comes fully loaded with the promises of God before the throne of God. He worships a God who has spoken. He worships a God who's holy. Can't talk to God without recognizing your sin. Can't come into God's presence without knowing that you shouldn't be there naturally and without his grace. To be in the presence of God is to be in the presence of holiness. You can't be in his presence without feeling dirty. And in face of God's repeated commands and warnings, his holy standard and his incredible long-suffering, Israel's sin seemed heinous. Daniel cringes at the thought of it. Listen to his words in verse 5 and 6, 11 and 14 and 15. We have sinned and done wrong. We've been wicked and rebelled. We've not listened. God had spoken, they'd not listened. God had commanded, they'd not obeyed. God had done great things for them, but they were not grateful. Listen to him. I prayed to the Lord my God. I said, O Lord, who keeps covenant, we have sinned and done wrong, and acted wickedly, and rebelled, turning aside from your commandments and rules. We have not listened to your servants, the prophets. Now just pause for a moment. Why is Daniel praying? Because Daniel had listened to the prophets. What do we know about Daniel from this book? We know that Daniel's a godly man. When confronted with whether he should bow to the emperor's image, he'd obeyed God's law, hadn't he? He'd kept God's law. He'd not bound or recognized a foreign image. Everything we know about Daniel is that he is a godly man whose purity and integrity have been constant over the years he has occupied high office in the land. But listen to his prayers. He does not pray, the people have sinned. Your people have sinned. Look at these people. He prays, we have sinned. This we, they, is foreign to his thinking. He is one with the people of God. He mourns the sin of the people as though they're part of him. Verse 7, Lord, you are righteous, but this day we are covered with shame. He prays, have mercy on us, O Lord, not them, but us. He realizes that the doom hangs over the people and means that hangs over him as well, because he is one with the people of God. You know, the wrath of the Lamb is too good for Christians that we are critical of. And it's too good for us. An intercessor has to be a realist. We have to see things as they are. And things as they are is that we too are sinners. And we have to confess our sin together. That's why we make public confession on Sundays when we come into God's presence. We do it corporately. Nobody can keep their mouth shut because we've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. What is the church? The face of the church is the face of a sinner, Martin Luther said. Why do you get frustrated with one another within the church? It's because you're all frustrating. We're all frustrating each other. We're sinners. And so as we come to God, we recognize we're coming to a God who's holy. And we're coming to a God, thankfully, who's also merciful. He doesn't appeal to God's justice. He appeals to God's mercy in verse 18. Very clearly appealing to God's mercy. Oh my God, incline your ear and hear. Open your eyes and see. We do not present our pleas before you because of our righteousness, but because of your great mercy. Micah, in his prophecy, says that he delights in mercy. Hebrews 4 says it's because of his mercy that we are not consumed. And so we cast ourselves on mercy. And then fourthly, he worships a God who is glorious. One scholar has written, Daniel's prayer is the anatomy of a heart conscious of the glory of God and wholly devoted to him. He's full of admiration and adoration of the character of God, what we call his attributes. The Old Testament word for glory means basically heavy or weighted. We sometimes use an expression, a person being worth their weight in gold. What do we mean? They're very valuable. They're very worthy. God is worth his weight. He is, verse 4, great and awesome. Verse 4 again, he keeps his covenant of love. Verse 7, he is righteous. Verse 9, he is merciful and forgiving. Verse 12, he fulfills his words. Verse 15, he delivers the oppressed. So that by the time you get to verse 19, what's he saying to God? Save your people, O Lord, for your sake. For your sake. This is his great motive. This is his high point of worship. If we can see our way through the meeting of our immediate needs, the solving of our immediate problems, the answering of our immediate questions, if we can come to the point where we want God's glory for itself, if we want God to receive glory for himself, if we want it to be expressed, if we want God's name to be vindicated, God's character to be revealed, if that's what we want, then we are poised then in a place where we ourselves will find greater boldness and greater freedom in our prayers. You see, as he dwelt on God's word, it gave Daniel an altogether larger view of God than many of his contemporaries had. When he read those words in Jeremiah, and Jeremiah 29 says, in that day you will call upon me and I will answer you. Jeremiah figured it out. It didn't necessarily mean that there had to be mass prayer meetings. That would be great if everybody caught on. But actually, that word was coming to him. If no one else was going to pray, he would pray. If no one else was going to talk to God, he would talk to God. And he would pray for the people as the people. And so he comes to God praying for the people as the people. We should do that too. We must never think, well, you know, there's not going to be anything done until we all come together and pray. That would be great. That would be good. But you can start. You can start. You can be the one to start it all off. You can be the one to put yourself in there in the business of praying to God, that God would hear from heaven and that God would answer prayer. Daniel's prayer, you see, rebukes the lack of God's centeredness in our lives and in our prayers. We can modify our statement at the beginning. A person's concept of God is the most important thing about them. And our view of God is shaped by his word. So what do we need to do? We need to let God's word get us wondering. Don't run away from the tension. Don't shy away from the doubts and discomfort it provokes. God's word was given to comfort the afflicted and afflict the comfortable. And you should ask God. If you have a question, ask him. If you've got a problem, bring it to him. If you have a concern, share it with him. If you're confused, well, go to him. Let God's word get you wondering and let God's word get you working down to the business of prayer. You said this. Didn't you say that? Haven't you promised? And see if it doesn't leave you worshiping. As we let God's word dwell in our hearts, as our minds are opened and enlarged by its teaching, as we get to grips with the really big and strong and holy and merciful God revealed there, as we discover that this God is for us, that he has committed all his powers and bent all his energies and risked all his reputation and sacrificed himself and his son for our salvation, we begin to grasp that all things are for your sakes, that grace, having spread through the many, may cause thanksgiving to abound to the glory of God. We don't need a national turning to God. We just need you to turn to God. One faithful person, this man, turned the tide of history. He turned the tide of history by his prayers. And only eternity will reveal the effects of our faithful witness. That's why Jesus said in his letters to the churches in Revelation, he who has ears to hear, let them hear That's all it takes. And God will hear from heaven, and he will act. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that you have given us this very wonderful gift of your word. We thank you for the holy apostles and prophets who wrote it. We thank you for the Holy Spirit who inspired it and breathed it out. We thank you that your word is true, that your word is life, that your word is good. Help us to hear it, to believe it, and to pray with prayer saturated by your words and your promises. In Jesus' strong name we pray. Amen. Receive the Lord's benediction. Now may grace, mercy, and peace from God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest and remain with you now and throughout your brief, uncertain life and pilgrimage, and bring you at last into everlasting glory through Christ our Lord. Amen. God be with you.